Joining us now to break down the GDP report and to weigh in on this year's economic prospects, we have with us Aris Dakanay, ASEAN economist at HSBC. Aris, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you for having us.
Hi, Aris.
Well, in your latest economic research document, I saw that your reaction was one of pleasant surprise. Is this because at least Q4 GDP of 2023 and full year were both higher than your forecast, correct?
Yes, it was indeed a pleasant surprise for us, except for the second quarter of the year. The first, the third, and the fourth quarter were all upside surprises for the Philippine economy. Bringing the full year growth to 5.6%, which we thought it would be at around 5.4%. Of course, this is a big pleasant surprise because there are two things that we thought would hinder the Philippine economy. One, it saw the highest inflation rate in ASEAN, and second, it saw the most aggressive tightening cycle across all the central banks in the region. And yet, the Philippine economy grew the fastest across ASEAN.
Yeah, but even with that, you're seeing in the meantime a slight dip in growth for 2024 from 5.6 last year. You're seeing 5.3 for this year. What factors are you looking at that could bring it down?
Similar to what Secretary Balisac had mentioned, the Philippines is exposed to, like everyone else in ASEAN, it's exposed to the vagaries of the global economy. You still have the Fed rate hikes taking a grip over U.S. demand. You still have China growing slower than what many hoped for. You still have disruptions in the Red Sea, disruptions in trade. You still see high rice prices across the globe. You still see the war in Ukraine and Russia. But then again, at 5.3%, yes, it is below the government target, but it's still pretty impressive. We do expect that at 5.3%, the Philippines is the second fastest growing economy in ASEAN for 2024. Because I do want to highlight that there's one thing in the Philippines that the other countries don't have, and that's a very, very strong labor market.
So you mentioned also that there are more than 2 million Filipinos that are in the labor force that demographically it didn't show in the numbers. And I found that part of your report to be very interesting. Can you expound on that, please?
So if you forecast what employment should be based on the demographic trend, you'll say, let's say it's 100 people working, but instead you have 102 or 103 people working. And as we all know, our current unemployment rate is actually the lowest in history, while our labor force participation rate is pretty high. So if you do the math, there are 2.4 million additional people working in the Philippines, contributing to the economy, earning a bit of extra income for the household. And this principle of having more hands on deck, more people contributing to the economy, being confident of using their skills to benefit the economy, it has supported growth in the Philippines, again, to be the fastest across ASEAN. With inflation still high, with food inflation still high, again, this principle of having more hands on deck helped the Philippines earn more income, smoothen consumption, and boosted growth.
You've mentioned it twice, the Philippines being the second fastest growing economy in ASEAN and could be the fastest growing. But I'm wondering, would you have any recommendation on how the government can possibly leverage that to attract more investments? How much could they squeeze that for attracting more investments here in the country?
That's actually what makes the Philippines so attractive when it comes to attracting FDI in particular. We do need the FDI in the Philippines, most especially that we are in a time when people are relocating their supply chains. People are moving to Thailand, to Indonesia, to Vietnam, in Malaysia in particular. And we do want to be part of that trend. And what makes the Philippines attractive are two things. One, we're a fast-growing economy. And two, we do have very favorable demographics. Our median age is 25 years old. Our population is getting bigger, our consumer market is getting bigger, and our growth is inclusive. So the key now here to leverage this growth, to leverage these advantages, we need to be able to, of course, attract this FDI. And one part of it is basically reopening the economy to foreign investment. Mm. We've seen how big the impact is when President Marcos allowed the full foreign ownership of renewable energy projects in the Philippines. And the moment it got approved, we saw the BOI approve its largest FDI project, which consisted around 7% of GDP. And it was majority of it was due to, you know, of German companies wanting to put up wind farms across the Philippines. So we see the impact. It's just a matter of opening up our economy to attract foreign investors.
To your point, Aris, there's currently a push to amend the economic provisions of the Philippine Constitution. Will this help in attracting investors the way the previous move to open up some of the ownership of local companies, as you said, help bring in foreign investors?
It did. Like as mentioned, we already saw the impact of opening an industry to foreign investment, particularly in the renewable energy space, which of course is a pretty hot industry nowadays. But to attract FDI further, we can champion what's already in place, in particular the ease of doing business law, mm-hmm. the EODB. If we're able to monitor its progress, to be able to champion its implementation, like what's the saying in Singapore, policy is implementation, implementation is policy. So if we're able to champion the reforms that we already did in the last 4 years, I do think it will be able to bring in more FDI for the Philippines, in the FDI, the technology, and the talent.
But those are two very different things. Ease of doing business is like a global phenomenon. Everybody's trying to do it. But to change the Philippine Constitution, is that okay?
Yes, if you're able to review what industries in the Constitution need to be opened up, that will be indeed very pleasant. There's one thing in the global trend right now, and right now, services is becoming more tradable. With services becoming more tradable, of course, you want to ride on that wave, ride on this advantage, this growing industry. And there are a lot of services in the Constitution that, if we're able to review, if legislation is able to review what's appropriate to open up, I do think a lot of investments will come in because, again, the Philippines' comparative advantage across ASEAN and across Asia as a whole is services. So opening up services will be good for the economy.
Now, talking about possible rate cuts, you believe that the BSP will do it maybe at the same time as the Fed would do it, maybe second half of this year. But are you seeing some factors that could lead the BSP to keep rates unchanged instead of starting cuts and going along with the Fed? And what could be the repercussions of not aligning itself with the Fed?
So, okay, first let's talk about inflation. I do think given the extension of Executive Order 10 and given the timely importation of rice to the Philippines, I do think there's a half a million tons coming in this month. The inflation environment in the Philippines has become more benign. So that's pretty good, but there's one risk that we need to monitor, and that's global rice prices. So far, there are trade restrictions in India when it comes to exporting rice. Just a matter of fact, India is the largest exporter of rice, so it was a big blow to supply. If this ban on exports continues even further, or if, let's say, El Nino affects rice production in Vietnam, in Thailand, there is a risk that rice prices go up further. And rice in the Philippines consists of around 9% of our consumer basket. So any increase in rice prices would lead to higher inflation. And if there's another inflationary wave, the BSP will be ready to keep rates higher for longer. And as Governor Remolona said, they're ready to hike rates further if needed. Mm-hmm. Second, what happens if we cut ahead of the Fed? Now, we have to look at around the current account deficit, or basically how reliant we are in terms of foreign capital. Our current account deficit so far is almost in line to what we saw in the 1990s, 1999, 1995. And during those times, no, the current account deficit wasn't that sustainable, and we need to basically trim the current account deficit even further, and that takes time. Now, if we're reliant to foreign capital and then there's a sudden change or sudden volatility when it comes to the peso against the US dollar, a lot of our foreign capital needs will be more difficult to pay for. Our foreign debt will be more, it's going to be more difficult for us to pay for our foreign debt. It's going to be harder for us to pay for our foreign liabilities in general, and that can potentially disrupt the Philippine economy. And that's actually what we saw when the peso hit 59 against the US dollar back in October 2022. So to limit the risk, to prevent that from happening again, I do expect the DSP to keep a solid margin from the US Fed rate. So we remember that Governor Medalla actually mentioned 100 basis points yield differential.
Yeah.
So I do think the BSP will maintain that to keep the peso not at a certain level, but stable enough to prevent financial risk.
And then you have oil prices to worry about.
Yes,
also,
indeed.
Yeah.
You guys are just depressing me right now. Oil prices, El Nino, rice prices, the wars.
So what else? Let's depress Ron even more. Are there other risks in the economy that we should know about?
No, actually, there's an upside risk in that if the labor market continues its strength, continues it's the boom that we're having in right now. So again, I mentioned there are 2.4 million people working today that on a normal day, on any day, they're not supposed to be working. And if the government sustained this, in particular, a lot of people were able to find work in the informal sector. Specifically, they were able to leverage on digitalization to be able to, again, find work and make ends meet. Mm-hmm. When I was home there in the Philippines over the holidays, my Christmas spread was pretty interesting because our dessert came from someone who quit her job to be able to become a full-time baker in through Instagram. The scented candle that we have over dinner was from a friend of mine who also is now doing part-time at work because she wants to be doing making scented candles on the side. And even I, for one, during that time, before flying to Hong Kong, I was selling bottled cocktails over social media. So there is this trend in the Philippines right now where people are leveraging on digitalization to be more entrepreneuring, to be able to, again, earn more incomes, to bring in creativity in the Philippines. So the gig economy right now in the Philippines is just really strong. So now the policy decision, or I guess the policy action, should be to be able to make sure that we make use of this trend to rejig, to retool the Philippine labor force to use digitalization for further growth. And I'm talking about, for example, AI. Mm-hmm. AI is both an opportunity and a risk. It's like a knife that can make the chef, the most efficient chef in the kitchen, but it can also hurt you. So it's important, and National Economic Development Authority knows this, NEDA knows this. We need to leverage on AI to make sure our productivity increases rather than replacing jobs.
Well, thank you so much.
I do think the Philippines, yes.
Thank you so much, Aris. We'll have to leave it there. Very hopeful view on the economy to counter your depression. Yeah. Thanks, Aris. See you again
soon. Thanks for that, Aris.
Thank you.